First, let me apologize. Since we only have 7 minutes, I usually announce that we're going to serve you breakfast because I usually go for 7 hours, having been trained by Gaddafi and Castro. I want to talk tonight about how Islamophobia is harming America. Hate has become the new normal in America, as in Europe. Today, Islamophobia is a metastasizing social cancer that threatens the very fabric of America and the religious freedom, security, and civil liberties of American Muslims. The recent Global Rally for Humanity last weekend is an example, targeting 20 U.S. cities, calling upon people to bring their weapons for an anti-mosque, pro-America rally. Rather than exercising free speech, and exercise in their free speech, as one could see, this is an extremist anti-government movement. But it's not new. If you think back to the attacks in Garland, Texas, when you had the cartoon situation, and then you had two outside extremists that came in, only 2 months before or 3 months before, Malik al-Mujahid and I were speaking there at a Muslim fundraiser, and before you knew it, when it got picked up on social media and on Fox, we suddenly had police, SWAT teams, a helicopter, FBI, and hundreds of people coming from different parts of America, some talking about bringing their weapons loaded and unloading them when they got there. This, regrettably, is where we have come in America. Where does this hate come from? Who are the enablers of Islamophobia? Leaders shape the interpretation of events and lead people. Political candidates and elected officials have a major role to play in terms of these attitudes and behaviors. In fact, polling data shows that usually when we have American elections, there's an enormous uptick in Islamophobia. So it's not merely when there's a radical event. For example, after the Boston bombings, you've not had the uptick that we have now with the presidential debates. One need only listen to the candidates to realize why that's the case. More recently, we had Republican presidential candidates like Trump and Carson, also Rick Santorum, who've gone in a similar path. Ever since Carson on September 20th said that he didn't think a Muslim could be president under our Constitution, was told that under the Constitution what he said, it violates the Constitution and did not back off. The reality of it is the donations went up, the numbers go up. As a young Republican said to me when Peter King was holding his hearings, he said, the reason why he does it, and if you watch after the hearings, it will be that the numbers of donations go up. And that's where we are, and that's what has to be counted. North Carolina's Republican primary voters, there was a September poll, 72% believed a Muslim could not be president. 40% also were more likely to say that Islam should be illegal. And how about our religious leaders? John Hagee, Rod Parsley, who were supporters of Mr. McCain, Pat Robertson, Franklin Graham. What are the things that they say? Muhammad is a pedophile, Islam is an evil religion, and they get the platform and they have their followers. We have to remember that in the United States, there is a significant minority that are the people who provoke hate crimes and hate speech. But at the end of my talk, I'm going to point out that there's another majority that's even more of an issue. What are the causes? Mass media, social media. Media Tenor did a study of 2001 to 2011, 975,000 pieces of media from major European and American sites. 2001, when you looked at coverage of the world, 2% was devoted to Islamic extremism, 0.1% to mainstream ordinary Muslims. 2011, 2% jumps to 25%. Mainstream remains at 0.1%. That is a statistic that we can't tolerate, but it's a statistic that continues to grow. If we take a look at social media, studies have shown, using IRS returns, that more than $180 million has been tracked from philanthropy supporting major anti-Islam and anti-Muslim websites. Yet, despite these facts, it doesn't jive with who Muslims are. Educationally, economically, religiously, we know that they are integrated from hard data as well as major polls. We know that they are increasingly politically integrated. Yet today, a majority of Americans believe that anti-Muslim discrimination is real. What's our challenge? Number one, deconstruction. We have to deconstruct all of the Islamophobic rhetoric that's out there. But more importantly, reconstruction. We have to emphasize protecting pluralism and ending Islamophobia, which is basically what the Bridge Initiative at our center at Georgetown has moved to bring into play. I think it's important to notice that today we need Muslims and non-Muslim Americans alike to call upon elected officials to defend American pluralism. We need a greater involvement of interfaith groups. When that happens, groups like the Global Rally fizz out, which happened. But keep this in mind, the Southern Poverty Law Center only 2 years ago and the FBI report this year affirmed that the major threat, the number one threat to safety and security in America are anti-government, white supremacist groups, not domestic Muslim extremists. Where do you see that in the media? The most important thing I leave you with today is the following. Islamophobia, like anti-Semitism, racism, and xenophobia, which parenthetically are all growing here and in Europe, threatens us all. This social cancer, with its fear-mongering, hate, requires the response and support of all who believe in fundamental rights, freedoms, and equal treatment under the law. And all who are concerned about if we don't have that, watching Islamophobia as it has, drive the foreign policy of the United States and the EU. Thank you.